Terrain analysis is arguably the most important skill set for backcountry skiers and snowboarders.
If weather conditions, snowpack layers, and human psychologies are uncertainties, terrain, however, is your stable-minded best friend. Being able to read the terrain allows you to understand the avalanche danger.
So this tutorial shows you what to look out for when you're analyzing the terrain so that you can be in the right places at the right times.
So here's a memory aid to help you remember six important features of the terrain. Situational awareness avoids avalanches catching skiers. The S stands for steepness. The three A's are anchors, aspect, and altitude. The C stands for consequence, and the S stands for shape. These six terrain features dictate the level of avalanche danger. Number one, steepness. Also known as gradient or slope angle, the steepness of a slope is extremely important to avalanches. Let's look at the frequency of avalanches plotted against the steepness of the slope. Bear in mind that this shows human-triggered avalanches, which is useful to us because in 9 out of 10 avalanche accidents, which involve skiers and snowboarders, the avalanche was triggered by the victim or someone in the victim's group. So here are the main things to remember. Dangerous avalanches are rarely triggered on slopes below 30 degrees. About 95% of the avalanches initiate on slopes between 30 to 50 degrees. And about 3/4 of the avalanches started in an even smaller window of between 34 to 45 degrees. On slopes above 45 to 50 degrees, the avalanche danger appears to decrease, but don't let this fool you. On these steeper slopes, a higher frequency of smaller slides effectively clean the slope, preventing the build-up necessary for larger slab avalanches. But on slopes above 45 degrees, smaller avalanches can have larger consequences, so it doesn't really get any safer. The most dangerous gradient for avalanches is about 39 degrees. I say about because it's different in different parts of the world, but the top of the bell curve is normally 37 to 40 degrees. These are the most dangerous slopes for avalanches. Be aware that this is just the starting zone steepness, and that when you're off-piste, you must be aware of locally connected terrain. There's no sense in thinking you're safe because you're on a sub-30 degree slope if you're standing beneath a 39 degree slope. Big avalanches might start on a steep slope and then pick up momentum and spill large distances across even flat terrain before coming to a stop. So the take-home messages from this are good and bad. The good news is you can largely avoid avalanche terrain by staying on sub-30 degree terrain. The bad news is that the most dangerous 30 to 45 degree slopes are the ones which are the most fun for skiers and snowboarders. But with this in mind, being able to read slope steepness is an excellent tool, and I'm going to show you a bunch of ways which you can do it in another video. Number two, anchors. Anchors such as trees, rocks, or bushes can help to hold a snow slab in place and decrease the avalanche danger. This is one reason why it can be safer to go skiing in the forests on those stormy powder days. However, anchors need to be densely spaced in order to be effective and to decrease the avalanche danger. If they are more spaced out, they won't anchor the slab in place, and instead of being your friend, they become your enemy. This is because they turn into obstacles which you don't want to crash into. Remember that around 1/4 of avalanche victims are killed by trauma from hitting rocks and trees on the way down. So when reading terrain, look for trees, rocks, or bushes, which could help to anchor snow slabs in place. Ask yourself, are they dense enough to decrease avalanche risk? Or do you think an avalanche could still occur, turning anchors into obstacles? Number three, aspect.
For off-piste skiers and snowboarders, it is extremely helpful to know which way a slope is facing, i.e. its aspect.
The aspect is important because it dictates how much sun and wind the snow there is exposed to. We need to know about this not only for avalanche safety, but also because it helps us to find good conditions. We'll start with wind. Wind can move the snow around 10 times faster than it can fall out of the sky, making it arguably the most important weather feature in avalanche terrain. When there is strong wind in the mountains, within minutes, delightful fluffy powder can be turned into dangerous wind slab. If we look at a ridge, wind strips snow off the aspect which faces towards the wind, and it deposits the snow on the aspect which faces away from the wind. The aspect which has had more snow loaded onto it generally becomes more dangerous for avalanches, especially if it is loaded quickly and the transported snow doesn't stick well to the existing snow. Not only is there more snow and weight now sitting on that slope, but also the wind-affected snow is no longer made up of loose, fluffy snowflakes. It becomes blocky and cohesive. It becomes wind slab, and it's a good recipe for larger avalanches. Wind is also responsible for building cornices. These are highly dangerous overhangs which kill people by either breaking off when you stand on top of them or by triggering avalanches when you're standing below them.
The second reason that the slope aspect is important is because it dictates how much the sun affects the snow. And the sun does a lot to transform the snow.
In the northern hemisphere, especially at mid-latitudes, south-facing slopes receive more sun and north-facing slopes receive less sun. If you're in the southern hemisphere, this is the other way around. However, no matter which hemisphere you're in, the sun still rises in the east. East-facing slopes receive the morning sun when temperatures are colder. West-facing slopes receive the afternoon sun when temperatures are warmer. The sun affects the avalanche risk, but it's not a linear relationship. Sometimes the sun makes the snow safer, and sometimes the sun makes it more dangerous. It depends on the recent conditions and the type of avalanches going on. I'll give you a couple of scenarios. Scenario one, if the sun rapidly warms up new snow after a storm, it increases the avalanche risk. It's a pretty good general rule that any rapid change to the snow makes it more dangerous, especially rapid warming. So, for example, after a storm has put down some new snow, sunny, south-facing slopes are likely to generate avalanche activity. In this scenario, more sun means higher danger. However, in a different scenario, sometimes less sun means higher avalanche danger. In this example, imagine a north-facing slope. It faces away from the sun, so it's colder. And in these colder temperatures, weak layers can be created within the snowpack. If the cold temperatures last a long time, so too can the weak layers that are created. These persistent weak layers can cause avalanches much longer after a storm, which takes skiers and snowboarders by surprise. It's because of scenarios like these, and because more powdery snow conditions attract more traffic, the more avalanche accidents happen on north and east facing slope aspects. So sometimes south-facing slopes are more dangerous, sometimes north-facing slopes are more dangerous. The point is, you need to know the aspect of the terrain. And here's some good news. The professionals who make the avalanche bulletin will do a lot of the hard work for you. The avalanche bulletin will tell you which aspects are more dangerous on a given day. You just need to be able to read the bulletin and to be able to translate that information into the real world terrain.
So next time you're out in the mountains, ask your partner which way is north and see if you can name the aspect of certain slopes. This will be an important step forward in your off-piste safety. Our fourth terrain feature is the altitude. So generally, as you go up a mountain, the temperature decreases, on average about 6 to 10 degrees centigrade per 1,000 meters of elevation gain.
For skiing and snowboarding off-piste around ski resorts, you will normally find that as your altitude increases, it becomes colder, snowier, windier, and there are fewer anchors. These conditions lead to a general increase in avalanche activity as you go up a mountain. Of course, there are exceptions to the rule, and sometimes lower altitudes can generate more avalanches too. For example, during wet avalanche conditions where lower altitudes are warmer. It's important, therefore, that you take note of the altitude, which is also known as the elevation of the terrain. The good news, again, is that the helpful professionals who create the avalanche bulletin will often warn you which altitudes to look out for. So read the avalanche bulletin and take note of your altitude when you are skiing or snowboarding. Number five, consequence. Thinking about the consequence of an avalanche allows us to understand how dangerous a particular slope is. Ask yourself, what will happen if that slope avalanches whilst you're on it? If you imagine yourself sliding down a slope out of control at 80 miles per hour, you'll get a pretty good idea of how dangerous the consequences are. Here's a few things which make for worse consequences. A terrain trap. This is a gully, a hole, or a sharp transition which would result in deeper burial and therefore amplifies avalanche danger. Obstacles, such as trees or rocks, which you would hit on the way down. Cliffs, which are obviously more dangerous if the avalanche takes you over them. And large slopes, where bigger avalanches would take you a longer distance. In contrast, smaller slopes with fewer obstacles and no cliffs or terrain traps can be relatively safer and have lesser consequence in the event of an avalanche. So when you're analysing terrain and choosing where to go skiing or snowboarding, think about the consequences of avalanches and crashes. It will help you to determine the danger and calculate the risk.
And our sixth terrain feature is the shape of the slope. Now, the shape of the slope can influence the chance and the consequence of an avalanche.
As we just mentioned, terrain shape features like gullies, holes, and terrain traps can mean smaller avalanches become bigger problems. Also, it's worth keeping an eye out for convex features of the terrain. On a convexity, not only does it get steeper, but the snowpack is often thinner, so humans can have more impact on any weak layers if they exist. Also, the snow is being pulled apart, similar to a rubber band being pulled tight. It is because of this that you often see avalanches triggered on convexities. In contrast, on concave slopes, similar to the interior surface of a basketball, the snow is being pushed together and it becomes less likely to avalanche. However, this only really helps on smaller slopes and isn't as significant as we used to think it was. Of course, avalanches can and do regularly happen on concave slopes, especially whenever the steepness is near 37 to 40 degrees. It's more about being aware of the danger of convexities than it is about letting your guard down on concave slopes. So pay attention to slope shape. When you're on a slope that is getting steeper and rolling away from you, you are probably on a convexity, which means higher risk of starting an avalanche.
So there we have 6 terrain features to look out for, and you can remember them with the phrase, situational awareness avoids avalanches catching skiers.
Next time you're out in the mountains, look at a slope and see if you can determine the 6 features of that slope. By building this skill set, you'll be able to work out the likelihood and consequence of an avalanche and to be able to choose appropriate terrain accordingly.
If you want a long and successful time off-piste skiing and snowboarding, then terrain analysis is your most reliable and valuable skill set. I hope that it helps you to have an awesome time in the mountains.